guest is Kathy Fries, and she's going to tell us how to restore our native prairie.
Hi, good
evening. Kathy.
Hi, happy Friday, Aya. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it very much.
So tell me, how did you get into this idea of restoring the prairie? Did you have this in mind before you bought the property?
No, actually, my husband and I moved here from Wisconsin, here to Licking, and we bought 23 acres here that we just fell in love with. It had a great view, and it was an older pasture. It was formerly a hay field that they had let turn into a pasture. And we started building our house, and we were hearing a lot of quail around, and we thought, oh my gosh, you know, my husband was raised in Missouri. I was raised in Louisiana, and we used to hear bobwhite quails all the time. And we started hearing quail here, and we started studying up on them a little bit. And we said, you know, this would be a great property to restore habitat for quail. They're already here. And why not, you know? And anytime that you restore habitat for quail, you're automatically helping for all the other animals as well. Wild turkeys, the birds, snakes, deer, fox, any other animals. If you restore for quail, you restore for all the other animals, and they will benefit from it as well. And that's how we got started.
So also predators, or
it's all a big food chain.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, and we learned that native predators, you know, benefit as well as everybody else. Everything has a predator, right?
Yeah.
Even dragonflies are predators. Butterflies, birds are predators of our butterflies and our bees and all the insects. But it's a big food chain, and all of the entire food chain benefits just by starting prairie restoration for quail.
Okay, so where did you get started? How do you get started, you know, restoring the prairie?
Well, first of all, you need to evaluate your property, your soil. What type of soil types do you have around? What are your goals? Do you want to have lots of trees and build a savanna area? A savanna, for example, is a scattered trees with an open canopy that allow partial sun to to the floor and allow other plants to grow. So that's a savanna. They're mostly made out of grasses, but I elected to have a lot of flowers in my savanna as well. So we have a mixture. We have a few savannas. We have an Indian grass area where the deer like to nest up and the quail. And then we also decided we were going to have a native prairie area with forbs. Forbs is the broad term for native wildflowers. And I started raising purple martins. And of course, purple martins benefit from a lot of insects because they're insect eating birds. And I said, okay, we're going to have this big wide open area that's going to be the prairie. And we had to do a lot of research about what are the types of wildflowers that would grow in that area. And of course, Missouri sits on a lot of clay and rock. And so we had to evaluate the area. We had to figure out what, you know, we needed to kill. So my husband went and took a lot of classes. He ended up being a master wildlifer and learned a lot about the wildlife here in Missouri. But anyway, back to the land, he learned about what types of foods, for example, quail like to eat and feed their young and so on and so forth. So we evaluated our land here. And since it used to be an old hay field, a lot of fescue had grown here. Fescue is a sod forming grass, and it tends to choke out all the other seeds. Native wildflowers and native grasses, all the good grasses, and any sod forming grass would. So the first step was to figure out how to get rid of all the fescue and all the other sod forming grasses. And then as well as the exotics. What is termed the exotics are generally the non-native invasives. And when I talk about non-native invasives, I'm talking about very got nice autumn olive, multiflora rose, Japanese honeysuckle, which is just horrible because Japanese honeysuckle will tend to suffocate all your other plants as well. So we had to make a plan really to put and decide, okay, what are our first steps? Because when you also kill off the fescue, you give those non-native exotics an opportunity as well to grow. So kill off the fescue. The non-natives try to take over. You have to make a plan of what you're going to do with the non-natives. And then you will open up what we call the seed bank. For hundreds and hundreds of years, we had native prairies here before, you know, the introduction of fescue and all these other non-native plants. And all of these seeds still live in this seed bank. But when you start killing off all that fescue and the non-native invasives, those seeds can start to come to the rise to the top. They're uncovered and they can go through stratification processes and they can start to bloom and grow without the competition from the non-natives. So we started with, let's kill the fescue and the non-natives, the invasive type plants like honeysuckle, and we use glyphosate. And we use some other herbicides to kill out all of these non-natives. You know, some of them won't just die with glyphosate. You have to actually up your game and use other herbicides that are recommended.
Let me ask you a question about that.
Sure.
Sounds kind of dangerous. What does that do to the watershed, you know, to the water?
So as I mentioned, Bob had gone to this master wildlifer. And he also became licensed to do this with the herbicides. And what you tend to learn is when you go to these classes and you study about these herbicides, is there is a lot of, I'm not sure what word to use here, but there's a lot of angst over people using herbicides. And if you read the labels, you follow exactly what you're supposed to do with these herbicides and keep them out of the waters. You know, you don't spray within so many feet of your pond. We have a half acre pond. And we don't spray around our pond because obviously it would kill all the fish and frogs and all the good stuff in our pond. We don't spray down our waterway that drains into the ponds. So follow the instructions and you don't, you only use what's required. More than what is called for in the ingredients is not necessarily a good thing. In fact, it can be a bad thing. Because you can end up killing things that you don't want to kill. Mm-hmm. So I was really impressed with what my husband learned about herbicides because I had heard all of the horror stories online and everything. And, you know, using the proper gear, following the proper safety precautions, glyphosate is a perfectly safe thing to use. And by the way, if these tools are taken away from us, such as glyphosate and triclopyr and 2,4-D and these other herbicides that we use, we will have no other way to fight the non-native invasive flora, such as multiflora rose and autumn olive, Japanese honeysuckle, because like I said, they will just take over and pretty soon all of the native plants will go away. And why is that a bad thing? Because everybody sees, oh, you know, Japanese honeysuckle has beautiful flowers and it smells wonderful, right? But the problem is it did not evolve in this country with our native insects. Our insects in this country have evolved with their own native plants. They've learned how to, they have evolved as far as, for example, the length of their tongues. So a bumblebee, a native bumblebee, has a long tongue. A honeybee, on the other hand, honeybees are not native to the U.S. Honeybee has a short tongue. So a bumblebee will be able to, for example, sip nectar from red clover. A honeybee would not be able to do that. But on the opposite side of that, the honeybees can get into the very shallow flowers and stuff where a bumblebee would have to go find other flowers. But that's just one example of how our insects have evolved in this country with the native plants. And while Japanese honeysuckle and multiflora rose has beautiful flowers and they smell very fragrant. My husband loves the smell, or not multiflora rose, I'm sorry, autumn olive. He loves the smell of autumn olive, but it's really bad for our prairies.
Let me ask you about the Carolina rose. Do you know that one? It was the one that I used to call something else because I was really confused about what it was. You know, that pink rose, that wild rose that shows up every once in a while. And and then I recently saw that it was called Carolina rose by a lot of people. So I.
Okay. So we have that pink rose too, but it's actually a native plant.
Okay.
Here in Missouri. Right. And it's really good for our insects here in Missouri. And that's how you distinguish the native plant from multiflora rose. And multiflora rose has the white, little white multi-petal flowers. And it will go crazy everywhere. But anyway, back if people take away glyphosate, we're not going to have tools to battle the non-native plants, and we will lose that battle because they're vicious, and it's really hard. For example, autumn olive, if you cut it down this year, it'll grow 10 sprouts next year.
No, you can't just cut it down. But does that mean that you have to use the insect, the herbicides every year over and over again?
No. Once, for example, calorie pears are horrible as well. And we found one growing in our ravine, and I cut it down and I used a chemical called Tordon on it. And it will never come back now because it kills it all the way into the roots. Cut it once, treat it with Tordon if it's a tree or a stump or something like that. Autumn olive is the same way. But if you just cut it and don't treat it with an herbicide, it will come back.
So did you have a very long list of what the invasives are and a very long list of what the natives are so that you wouldn't, you know, get them confused?
Yeah, and, you know, it's kind of like our insects evolving with the native plants. We evolved because it was a long learning curve for us because we had never really done this before. But we got out books. My husband went to the classes with Missouri has a great program for becoming a master wildlifer, master gardeners and other things here. And he learned a lot about it. And of course, we bought a lot of books and we did a lot of reading. We did a lot of online research. And as every plant came up, we would have to go look it up and figure out, well, what is this one? Is it good or is it bad? And believe it or not, we started this in 2007. And even to this day, we still discover new stuff on our property. And sometimes it's another invasive that some bird ate a seed somewhere in someone's exotic garden and brought it here. But anyway, back to the evolution of our prairie. Once we started, we have 23 acres, as I mentioned, and we picked sections to work on because it's a huge undertaking. And it's not something that you just go out one year, do it, and you're done. You have to make a plan. You have to choose what you want to grow in certain areas. And the weather has to be just right for certain things. For example, Japanese honeysuckle. Japanese honeysuckle should only, you should only try to kill Japanese honeysuckle in the fall, because you can spray it in the fall when nothing else is green and only kill the Japanese honeysuckle. If you spray it in the spring, you kill everything else around it as well. So wait until the fall and spray Japanese honeysuckle. So I spent all last summer just waiting and praying for fall because I wanted to go tackle this particular patch of Japanese honeysuckle. And I just hid my face every time I went by it. So because it drove me crazy that it was growing here again. But make a plan and pick certain areas. And by the way, native wildflowers take a while to grow and get established. So there are native wildflowers that will grow right away the first year after you plant them. You spread the seeds in the winter and they will start to sprout in the spring. Some of them will go ahead and bloom the first year, but most of them will not. Native wildflowers tend to have the deepest roots and they really get down into the soil. For example, a compass plant will grow a 16 foot root into the ground. And I find that fascinating. 16 feet. Can you imagine?
How many feet up was that? Because you were in that picture with it.
Yeah. The one I was in the picture with, it was 7.5-8 feet tall.
Wow.
So that's a huge plant. But that's how they survived the drought. And that's the beauty about native plants as well, is they are, I won't call them drought tolerant, but they will survive a drought a lot better and a lot longer than any of the non-natives because of these longer roots that they have. And you can look online and find, do a Google search if anyone's listening. Do a Google search on native plant root depth. And you'll find these charts that show just incredible root depths on all these various plants. The compass plant, the prairie blazing star, comb flowers, etc. They all have roots that just go anywhere from 2 to 3 feet all the way to 16 feet. It's quite amazing, actually.
Yeah. So do you want to introduce one of your videos?
Sure. So like I mentioned earlier, we'll start with where are we at today? What's blooming in June right now today?
Okay.
That's my first video. And I just wanted to show that one briefly to show everybody. Here's what's blooming today. And it's kind of fun. And by the way, it won't be the same in July or August. But yes, I will.
Okay, so the Foxglove Beard Tongue has had a great year. And the comb flowers are having a great year also. It's pale purple comb flower, Echinacea I can't say the word.
Purpura?
Yes.
And the yellow comb flower?
Is that your pond in the distance?
It is, yes.
The tree swallows really enjoy it out here because all of the native flowers attract a lot of insects. So the tree swallows catch the insects to feed to their young, as well as the purple martins that you hear in the background here. More comb flowers over there. And Foxglove Beard Tongue. Lots of insects out here today. And this is all my meadow out here. Foxglove beard tongue having a great year.
So that's what it looks like right now.
That's what how it looks today. Yes. And it really benefited from all the rain we had up until about a week and a half ago.
It's so dry now.
Now it's crazy dry, but you can see they're all still hanging in there. And it's really cool because it's really cool because as long as those plants are thriving, the insects are attracted. My purple martins are just flying through there like crazy, and the tree swallows are scooping up all the insects. I have 14 nests of tree swallows, and I have 80 pairs of purple martins right now that are all feeding young. So we have to have a lot of insects around here right now.
Yeah. I like the way that, you know, even though you played around with what was there, it's not uniform. It doesn't look like, you know, a farmer's field at all.
No. And that's the beauty of, so the foxglove beard tongue that I mentioned, yes, the wildlife does help control mosquito issues. And you'll find this to be very funny, Seth. you know what eats the most mosquitoes? Any guesses? Dragonflies.
Really?
Dragonflies, yes. And wow. So if you plant, for example, I have pickerel weed that I planted in my pond, and that helps the dragonflies because they lay their eggs on these pickerel weeds underneath the water, the nymphs, and they grow and blah, blah, blah. And all these dragonflies hatch, and they help control mosquitoes. Yes. Now, the irony of that here is that my purple martins also love to eat dragonflies.
Oh, but so not mosquitoes, huh?
there used to be the myth that purple martins ate mosquitoes, but I always give the analogy of it like this. A purple martin eating a mosquito is the equivalent of a football player running the length of a football field to eat a peanut. It's just not worth the effort. Now, if they're there, sure, they'll eat them. But the vast majority of what purple martins eat are the insects that are flying around in my field. A variety of wasps, a variety of bees. It's just amazing. Flies, a variety of flies as well. Butterflies, moths. All skippers, everything. But anyway, back to the foxglove beard tongue. What I wanted to say about the foxglove beard tongue, that was not a flower that we planted in our seed. When we put out the seed, foxglove beard tongue was not part of our 10 pounds of seed that we put out there. That was a volunteer. That was in the seed bank. And when we removed all of that fescue that was growing out there, the foxglove beard tongue said, "Hey, thank you. I'm going to grow." And it did. So that was pretty cool. The cone flowers and stuff we did plant. But it all goes into a big mix, and you just scatter it randomly. It finds its place, and it starts growing. What I was going to say earlier, too, I forgot to finish, was that you will have some flowers in a native wildflower mix that will bloom their first year, but the variety, the most of them will not bloom until their second, and, well, I would say maybe another 25 or 30% of them will bloom their second year, but the vast majority of them do not bloom until their third year. So you don't get an immediate wow factor, especially from something like cone flowers, for example, because cone flowers do take about 3 years to sprout, but you do get some like lanceleaf coreopsis and things like that in the in the interim to help. And then, of course, whatever's in the seed bank will come up as well also. So volunteers is one of my favorite topics. And I call them volunteers because they're not seeds that I scattered myself. For example, we have a plum grove that we call our volunteer plum grove, because when we uncovered that particular area, there were some plums seeds apparently in the bank there, and they sprouted, and we have this huge plum grove now. And that's the topic of my next, that's one of my next videos here, is a couple of volunteers that we've had here.
Okay, so this would be the next one, and you've already removed the one that was there before, is that right?
Correct.
Okay, good, okay.
These are the Bidens that grew up in the area where we killed all the fescue and tried to kill all the autumn olive, but some of it's come back. We built two brush piles in here for the quail when the grandkids were here.
So this is a close-up of some milkweed that was also in the seed bank here, and it grew. And there are three different types of bees on this particular milkweed. There's an emerald bee and two others that I don't know the name of, unfortunately. But I just found it fascinating that there were multiple types of bees that are used.
And that's a butterfly milkweed, right?
Correct. Butterfly milkweed. Yes. And that was the end of that one.
Okay. All right. Shall we go on to the next one? It looks like it's Biden's.
Yes. Okay. So the next one is just a close-up of an insect swarm on the Biden's. It gives you more of a close-up about what's going on there. It was a huge swarm, and they're called Pennsylvania leather wings that showed up.
So what do we know about the Pennsylvania leather wings? Do they like other plants also?
They do, but for whatever reason, they really swarmed the Bidens. They swarmed them every year. I'm not sure why, but the Bidens were volunteers as well that have been in the seed bank for years and years. And I just found that fascinating that they swarmed it like that.
Yeah, okay. we had Bidens as well.
Yeah, I think if I recall correctly, there are eight types of Bidens in Missouri. Okay, so this next one.
Now we do have a comment from a viewer.
My grandparents had a plum grove. I was just saying a few days ago how cool it would be to have one there. They are very cool. they spread on their own via more, you know, they form a thicket, and I love how they form this thicket and everything dies underneath them. And the quail love to hang out underneath there because they can take their young underneath and they're protected from the hawks above, which is pretty neat that they know to do that. I'm going to add one more here.
Okay.
Okay. Right. You'd like to play the next one.
Okay.
So these are bumblebees on common milkweed. And that's a great spangled fritillary butterfly there. Mm-hmm. I saw one on your opening scene as well, Aya.
Yeah, they really like my milkweed.
Yeah.
It's very more so than monarchs. I always wanted to see a monarch on a milkweed, but it's usually the great spangles.
Yeah.
But you've got a lot of common milkweed there. Did you plant that?
I'll tell you what happened with this. This is actually a mulched area. And about 3 or 4 years ago, I got a grant from, I think it was called Moving with Monarchs. And they sent me 75 plugs, and they just come in these little 1-inch round things, and they ship them. And I think I just had to pay for the shipping. So they sent me 75 of them, and I took those 75 and I put them into 4-inch pots, and I set them into that mulch bed. And what happens is that when I pulled those pots out in the spring, common milkweed spreads via rhizoming, what's called rhizoming. It's mm-hmm. just the roots are rhizomes. They're big, yeah. thick roots. Yeah. And when I pulled those out, I broke off the rhizomes, and those things have just gone crazy in that bed. And I'm like, okay, go for it. It's great because it's all right there, and I have my own little seed farm now for common milkweed.
Okay, so let me ask you for some advice, because a few years back, I had some common milkweed. Not as much as you have there, but I had some, and it was pretty good, and I liked it. But it got squeezed out by poison ivy.
Oh. You know?
And I didn't know what to do about that, because isn't poison ivy also native?
That is a great question. So native poison ivy is a native plant. Yes. It's what's called a nuisance plant, though, obviously, for obvious reasons, right? Because it
right.
can take out other things, and not to mention it can irritate you. How do you get rid of poison ivy? There are a couple of ways. One, you can obviously spray it with glyphosate. Or you can mow it. And if you mow the heck out of poison ivy, and I would have to find how many times you have to do it, 3 or 4 times a year, it will go away. Poison mm-hmm. ivy will go away. You remember my Japanese honeysuckle bed I told you about that I killed? Well, guess what it's full of now? Poison ivy.
Yeah.
So Bob's going to tackle it with our bush hog because it's a larger area. But yeah, you can mow poison ivy and make it go away if you mow it a few times. Every time it gets green leaves on it, because it uses up all the energy in its roots to try to keep regrowing. And if you keep mowing it down after it grows a few leaves, it'll use up all of its energy and die.
But I mean, is Bob allergic to poison ivy? Because I would be afraid to mow it.
You know? We both are. And by the way, never burn poison ivy. My mother learned that the hard way. But yes, we both are. So he stays up high on the bush hog and mows it down.
Okay.
Yeah. Yep. That's one way to get rid of it. Or you can spray it. But yeah, it will choke out other plants. So, The next video that I wanted to share, you can just share the first minute of it. Okay. I had a hard time shortening that one, but it just shows Rattlesnake Master did really well here when we planted it. And I was shocked how many insects really love this flower. It's a strange looking flower, isn't it?
Yeah.
This is called Rattlesnake Master for obvious reasons. It's very sharp needles, but those particular butterflies are called pearl crescents. Mm-hmm. And you'll see a common buckeye on here as well. But they're very teeny little flowers inside those sharp pokey heads. That there are nectaring on there.
They look sort of like something out of science fiction, you know, because of their shape.
It's a very strange looking plant. And at first I was a little worried because it was taking over. And I thought, well, it's not, it doesn't seem like a very good plant, but the insects love it. And by the way, this is the one that turns, all of those turn into seeds in the fall. And the goldfinches partake of all the seeds, and they strip them in the fall of all the seeds. And that's also a prairie blazing star. Okay, the sulfur, that's a large male sulfur yellow flower, butterfly.
The yellow one, yeah.
Yeah, a clouded sulfur.
Yeah.
I hadn't seen one of those around here before until then. So you can kill it here, Aya.
Okay, all right.
Yep. And then two more videos. If you'd like to start the next one.
Okay.
So this is the savanna area. And I thought I had audio with this one. Does that, will it play? No?
No.
Okay. So the grass you see there is bluestem to the right that we just walked by. I've got some poison ivy growing there on that tree. And... But this area is filled with what's called gray-headed coneflower. This is my savanna. Remember, we talked about scattered trees with a somewhat open floor, open canopy to allow some sun in.
Yeah.
And we've got right there, that grass that I'm zooming in on is called river oats. And quail love river oats because it literally goes to seed like oats.
Mm.
And there's some more seed. River oats grass. But I really like this area because of the partial shade, and there's more river oats. And there's some ironweed. That ironweed is a volunteer. The lanceleaf coreopsis, the other coreopsis plants in here, we did plant those. There's more rattlesnake master that also happens to grow in this savanna. The gray-headed coneflower. But I love this area because it's nice and cool in here. So I can walk through here without burning out in the hot sun. Royal catchfly actually grew in there this year. That's a little red spot. But that was the only... red flower I could get to grow in there. Royal catchfly that I could get to grow in here. So I won't try to plant royal catchfly again. It just didn't do well here.
Now, what about the Indian paintbrush? Do you have a video with that?
I do not have a video of the Indian paintbrush, no. But the Indian paintbrush is the red flower that you showed in the first picture. And that is one of the very first bloomers in March. We know we've hit spring when the Indian paintbrush blooms, and boy, is it pretty. I do have some pictures coming up in the last video, and I hope the sound plays in it because, and that right there is Virginia ryegrass, by the way. And that is my savanna.
Okay. All right.
Okay. And then one last video to upload here. And let me see if we can get that uploaded.
Okay. I see it. Shall I play it?
Just 1 second. Let me say something about it. When you are considering planting native wildflower seeds, it's important to consider their bloom period. And it took us a while to get here, but what I've done is I've put together a season of colors all the way from April through, I believe I ran this one through, August or September. I can't remember where I ended with it, but it's a very long period. And I just I stitched together a bunch of pictures to show what the colors are throughout each blooming month. And it's important to have different flowers blooming each month to support the insects that are in the area at the time. And of course, at the beginning of migration and the end of migration as well. So I wanted to share that with you because it's pretty neat. Okay.
Beautiful.
Thank you. Yeah. It's and as you saw in there, you know, we didn't talk a lot about them, but grasses are important too. And the last grass that you saw me with was we planted a lot of big blue. It's called big blue. And I was shocked to find it the tallest one I've ever found here on the property. It must have been 8 or 9, 10 feet tall. So I was quite pleased to see that.
We have a lot of comments. I don't know if we can get them all.
Thank you, Sarah.
Yeah. So how much work does this require on a yearly basis to keep it that way?
Good question. So native prairies, require mowing about once every 3 years and burning. Why is that? Because when you mow it down after about 3 years, you get a lot of stuff that you've cut, right? The stalks and leaves, dead stalks and leaves and stuff like that. And that can pile up and cover up your seed bank. So what benefits your native prairie every 3-4 years is a fire. And fire helps not only remove all the dead duff and everything from 3 or 4 years of buildup, it also helps scarify the seeds. And some seeds from some plants require fire for scarification. Seeds from other plants require a cold, moist stratification. And that's why they need to be planted, say, in January and February in around our latitude because of the cold, moist, freezing and thawing from the rain and the ice and the snow and then the thaw. And what happens when it thaws, actually after a big freeze, is the ground heaves and it kind of breaks up and opens up the soil. And when the ground contracts again, it brings those seeds in. And it, you know, along with scarification, it also naturally plants those seeds as well that have dropped from your flowers that you already have out there. So fire every 3 or 4 years, and then And of course, there are some plants that the seeds require scarification by going through a bird's digestive system. That's just a unique little piece of trivia there as well. I don't know which ones they are.
Okay. Yeah. So do you think that the reason that we don't have the, you know, the prairies sticking around is that we're preventing natural fires from taking place? In other words, would we normally have had a big fire every 3 years or so?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. From the lightning or whatever. And a lot of people are removing all the dead brush, you know, the dead wood and stuff. And that's how fires get started and keep going. And of course, all the buildup of, you know, houses and lawns, people want lawns, you know, and yes, they need fire and they need native prairies. All of our animals need native prairies to survive. And I've got my 23 acres of solitude here, and I'm hoping that this will inspire other people to put out or to build their own little prairie, even if it's a 10 by 10 square in your front yard. You know, stop mowing it and just kill off the fescue and see what happens, or plant some milkweed, something easy to grow that, you know, lanceleaf coreopsis, tick seed coreopsis, those types of flowers grow rather quickly, black-eyed Susans. And if you just do a 10 by 10 square, if everyone did that, they would immensely help our native pollinators. You know, the native pollinators are suffering now because of the big hay fields, the agricultural areas. Now farmers are starting to put in more natural fence rows around their hay fields and things like that, and let native wildflowers and plums and things like that grow. And that's starting to help our native pollinators. So everybody out there that's listening, I hope you put in a 10 by 10 square foot at least, or heck, rip up your whole yard and do it.
Well, I'm thinking of doing it, the part of my yard that is being mowed. Now, I have only 10 acres. Five of them are already turning into a forest now. So yeah, we're way past the savannah stage.
Right. Yeah. And I, you know, speaking, because I know you have let some cedar trees grow. Cedar trees are one of my nemesis. I'm allergic to them, for number one thing. I have all things to be allergic to here in Missouri, a red cedar tree. But red cedar trees can actually turn into a nuisance, just like poison ivy, because cedar trees can take over and choke out other beneficial things as well. So it's all about forest management. We've learned that here too. I almost died the first time my husband brought out a chainsaw and cut a tree. And I thought, oh, good God, we're not supposed to be cutting trees. What about the environment? But actually, it has proven to help our trees by thinning them out. They were far too crowded. So when he started thinning out our trees, they, guess what happened? They started growing more limbs, and they started growing more leaves, and the trunks started getting bigger. And, you know, according to all of the environmental papers that I've read, the trees are now absorbing actually more carbon because of their healthier trees. So it still hurts to cut down a tree, but we still do it.
Well, I think maybe I can turn it in, turn some of my trees into Christmas trees or something.
There you go. There you go.
Yeah. Also, I wanted to ask you about transporting milkweed. So I tried to save some common milkweed from a spot that we do mow and transported it to another spot, and it lived, you know, didn't die on me the way sometimes it does. Mm-hmm. But it has not been flowering at all.
Hmm.
And this is several years into the transporting of it.
Is it still just one plant?
No, it's several plants. It's actually spread out, but it's doing it by the root, not not with flowers.
It's rhizoming.
Yes.
Yeah. Wow, I wouldn't know why it wouldn't flower. That's very odd. Unless it's just drying out, maybe where it's at, and it doesn't like it where it's at, maybe.
It's not drying out. It's pretty, you know, it's green. It's growing.
Yeah.
I keep looking toward the top where I think the flower is supposed to be, and it's not there.
Wow, that's amazing. I don't know why it would do that. That's very odd. It's kind of funny because the farmer in the field north of us, he has a huge, and I don't know if he knows this or not, but in his corner, he probably has a quarter acre of common milkweed growing.
Oh, and, wow.
Yeah, it's just growing up in the middle of his hay, well, not the middle, in the corner, as I said. And it's funny because he goes through and he mows down all of his hay and he mows down the milkweed. Right about this time in June. And the bad part is he's mowing down the milkweed. It probably has caterpillars on it. But the good part is, and this fascinates me, this milkweed sprouts right back up and it's ready for the fall monarch migration by August.
Well, you know, the monarchs are really not that interested in the flowers. They are interested in eating the leaves and the stems and things. So
yeah, that's it. My milkweed that you just saw with all the flowers on it, it was only about 6 or 8 inches high when I first saw the first monarchs coming through, and they were laying eggs all over it. And of course, by the time it reached a foot and a half or so, the eggs were hatching and the caterpillars were chewing them down. But I don't see any caterpillars on there right now at all.
Yeah, I didn't see any caterpillars this year. I saw them other years, but not this year.
Yes, exactly. Trees need to be culled for the health of the rest. Yes, I learned that. It was hard, but boy, they're really doing great now. And I tried to explain this to other people, and you know, you just have to see it to believe it.
Well, I wish that my deer would just decide to cull the trees that need to be culled.
I understand. You do have a great deer population there, Aya. And yeah, now a fox.
Yeah.
Good. Well,
I really enjoyed hearing all about and seeing your beautiful flowers and your fields full of flowers.
Thank you. Thank you, Aya. Well, I hope it has inspired someone. I hope that someone says, hey, I want those flowers, and goes out and plants them, because we really need everyone to do their just a little bit, even. It doesn't have to be on this scale, but I know what I'm going to be doing when I retire. I mean, we still take a quarter acre here and there and rejuvenate it, in other words, we haven't finished our 23 acres yet, so I know what I'm going to be doing when I retire.
Okay. Well, is that going to be soon or a long time from now?
Oh, and I don't know with this economy. I don't know right now. It's a little scary, but yeah. Well, thank you. I really appreciate you having me. Really do appreciate it. This is one of my other passions, and I've enjoyed sharing it. So thank you very much for the opportunity.
Okay. And next time, maybe I can invite you again to tell us about the purple martins.
Oh, that'd be great. Yeah, that'd be fun. Absolutely. Okay.
Well, anyway, have a wonderful night and enjoy your time with your grandkids.
Thank you very much. I have a great weekend. Bye-bye. Thanks, everyone.
Bye-bye.